It is well known amongst Muslims that the Jews and Christians at the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him, knew about the truth of his prophethood and still concealed it. Many have spoken about the different prophecies mentioned in the Injil and the Torah, but nine of people have mentioned the attitude of the Jews and Christians at that time towards the Prophet, peace be upon him. An attitude which further proved their insincerity on one hand, and the sincerity and truthfulness of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, on the other hand. In this video, we will discuss a collection of authentic narrations telling the story of the Jews and the Christians of 7th century Arabia in the context of the appearance of the new Arabian Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Salama ibn Salama al-Ansari narrates, "While I was young, there used to be a Jewish neighbor living next door to us. Once he came to the place where our tribesmen used to sit and began to talk to us about resurrection, the judgment day, reckoning, hell, and paradise. I was the youngest of them at the time. He was talking to idolaters who never believed that there would be resurrection. So they asked, 'Damn, is that possible that people will be resurrected again and they will either go to hell or paradise and they will be rewarded according to their deeds?' 'I swear by the one who is sworn by, this will happen,' he said. 'How can we be sure of that you are talking about?' they said. 'A prophet will be sent soon. His locusts will be here,' he said, pointing by his finger between Mecca and Yemen. 'When can we see him?' they asked. Looking at me, he said, 'If this boy becomes a young man, he will see him.' Salama said, 'Not many years have passed until the prophet was sent and this Jew was still alive among us. We believed in him, but he didn't out of envy and rancor. We asked him, "Woe to you! Aren't you the one who told us about him?" He said, "Yes, I did, but he is not a prophet."
The Jews used to pray for victory in the name of Muhammad. In fact, the Jews, though many of them believed in Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, refused to believe because they wanted this prophet to be from them. The Holy Quran commented on such approach of the Jews in the following verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, "And when there came to them, the Jews, a book from Allah confirming what is with them, the Torah and the Injil, although aforetime they had invoked Allah for coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in order to gain victory over those who disbelieved, then when there came to them that which they had recognized, they disbelieved in it. So let the curse of Allah be on the disbelievers." Ibn Kathir says in his tafsir, "Before this messenger came to them, they used to ask Allah to aid them by his arrival against their polytheistic enemies in war. They used to say to the polytheists, 'A prophet shall be sent just before the end of this world, and we, along with him, shall exterminate you, just as the nations of Ad and Iram were exterminated.'" Also, Muhammad bin Ishaq narrated that Ibn Abbas said, "The Jews used to invoke Allah for the coming of Muhammad in order to gain victory over the Aus and Khazraj before the prophet was sent. When Allah sent him to the Arabs, they rejected him and denied what they used to say about him." Hence, Mu'adh bin Jabal and Bishr bin al-Bara bin Ma'arur from Bani Salama said to them, "O Jews, fear Allah and embrace Islam. You used to invoke Allah for the coming of Muhammad when we were still disbelievers, and you used to tell us that he would come and describe him to us." Salam bin Mushkim from Bani al-Nadir replied, "He did not bring anything that we recognize. He is not the prophet we told you about." And Allah then revealed this ayah about their statement. Ibn Kathir also narrates that Abu al-Aliya said, "The Jews used to ask Allah to send Muhammad so that they would gain victory over the Arab disbelievers. They used to say, 'O Allah, send the prophet that we read about in the Torah, so that we can torment and kill the disbelievers alongside him.' When Allah sent Muhammad, and they saw that he was not one of them, they rejected him and envied the Arabs, even though they knew that he was the messenger of Allah." And the Holy Quran, commenting on the situation, says, "Those whom we have brought the scripture recognize him as they recognize their own children. But indeed a group of them do conceal the truth while they know."
Prior to the advent of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Jews emigrated to Medina and Tema because they understood the prophecies in their holy book, especially those which refer to the locus of the message and also the place of his determination. Ibn Ishaq says that he was told by some of Medina's dwellers, known as the Ansar, that the reason behind their converting to Islam was that they used to hear the following from the Jews. We were idolaters, and they had a holy book. They had knowledge that we did not have. There used to be skirmishes between us. If we defeated them, they would threaten us by saying, the advent of a new prophet is approximating, and we will kill you the same way the nation of Ad and Aram was killed. These threats were repeated several times in different occasions. When this prophet was sent, we believed in him when he called us to God, but they disbelieved.
Short before the Islamic call dawned on the Arab Peninsula, a pious rabbi by the name of Ibn al-Hibban came from Sham to the city of Medina, the city to which the Prophet was destined to emigrate to. He read in the Holy Book that the city of Medina will be the place to which the Prophet would emigrate, so he came to dwell in Medina to be amongst those who would follow and support. Ibn Ishaq narrates that Asim bin Amr bin Qatada told him that a leader from Bani Qurayza, a Jewish chief tribe at that time, said, a rabbi from Sham came to live among us. His name was Ibn al-Hayban. I have never seen a man who perfect his prayer like him. He came to us 2 years before the advent of the Prophet. When there was a drought, we used to go to ask him to pray for rain. He would say, I swear I won't do unless you give some alms before you go. We would ask, how much? He would say, a measure of dry dates or barley. So we did what he asked. He would take us to the back of the mountain, and there we asked for rain under his leadership. No sooner he left his place than rain fell down superfluously. He did this twice or thrice. When he was dying, we gathered around him. He said, O Jews, do you know what reason made me leave the land of welfare of Sham to the land of hunger and hardships of Medina? We said, you know best. I emigrated because I expected a prophet to appear, and this is his time to appear. This town is the place where he will emigrate to. Believe in him, let nobody else precede you. And he died shortly after his words. When it was the night on which Bani Qurayza, a major Jewish tribe at that time, was defeated, three Jews left their fortress and called the others, O Jews, we assure you that he is the prophet whom Ibn al-Hayban told you about. They said, what are your proofs? They said, we swear he is as was described, and they all embraced Islam.
It was a common theme for the Jews to have immediate hostility towards the Prophet ﷺ right upon recognizing him as the prophesied one. It's known that the Jews were a proud people, and they expected that the Prophet to be from amongst them. The fact that the Prophet came from the Arabs was something they could not accept. Ibn Ishaq narrates that Safiya, the mother of the believers, who used to be a Jew herself, said, I was the closest child to my father's and my uncle Abu Yasir's heart. Whenever they saw me with a child of theirs, they would pamper me so tenderly to the exclusion of anyone else. However, with the advent of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and sitting in Quba with Bani Amr bin Auf, my father, Huyay bin Akhtab, and my uncle, Abu Yasir bin Akhtab, went to see him and did not return until sunset when they came back walking lazily and fully dejected. I, as usually, hurried to meet them smiling, but they would not return to me for the grief that caught them. I heard my uncle, Abu Yasir, say to Ubay and Huyay, is it really he? The former said, it is he, I swear by Allah. Did you really recognize him? They asked. He answered, yes, and my heart is burning with enmity towards him.
Qus ibn Sa'idah, the leader of his clan, was a Christian bishop and a poet. The passionate sermon he gave during the Awqaz fair to a crowd that included the Prophet to be, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which he spoke of the awaited coming, is remembered for its wisdom. He said, people, come, listen, learn, and take a lesson. Whoever lives, dies. Whoever dies, perishes. And whatever is bound to happen, happens. Rain falls, grass grows, and children are born to take over the place of their parents. Then they all depart. Occurrences are ceaseless. They all follow up on one another. Beware and lend an ear to my words. The skies are filled with news, the ground with lessons to be taken. The earth is a mattress stretched out, and the skies a lofty ceiling. The stars will expire, and the seas will come to a rest. Whoever comes does not stay, and whoever leaves does not return. Who knows? Is it that they are so comfortable where they are that they remain there? Or are they withheld and put to sleep? I swear that there is a religion more beloved to God than the one you now follow, and a prophet of God will come, and his coming is near. His shadow hovers over your heads. Blessings to him who believes in the prophet and basks in the light of guidance. Woe to him who rebels and opposes him. Woe to those who squander their lives in ignorance. Mankind, beware of heedlessness. Everything is mortal. Immortality lies only with the Almighty, who is one, without partners, without a like. He is the only one worthy to be worshipped. He begets not, nor is he begotten. People of Ayyad, where are your fathers and forefathers? Where are the people of Ad and Thamud, who built exquisite mansions and abodes of stones? Where is the Nimrod and the Pharaoh, who indulged himself in worldly riches and said to his people, "Am I not your greatest lord?" The earth ended up grinding them all in its mill. Even their bones have now rotten away, scattered. Their abodes stand deserted, now inhabited by dogs. Do not ever become heedless like them. Do not tread their path. Everything is mortal. Only the Almighty is not. There is many a passage to enter the river of death, but alas, no way out. All things great or small migrate. Whatever befalls all shall befall you too. When he made this beautiful speech, Qus ibn Sa'idah was not aware that the prophet he was announcing was present and listening. Qus did not live long enough to witness the prophet's call to Islam, but his entire tribe, called the tribe of Ayyad, believed in the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, once they were made aware of him. The Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, is reported to have asked the delegation of Ayyad about Qus bin Sa'idah, to which they responded with, "He has perished, Messenger of Allah." The Prophet is reported to have said, "Never could I forget the speech given by Qus ibn Sa'idah at the Uqaz fair. When mounted on a camel, he said, 'Whoever lives dies, whoever dies perishes, and whatever is bound to happen, happens.'" The Blessed Messenger, peace and blessings be upon him, then asked them whether there was anyone remaining among them who could repeat his speech. One of them stood up and recited the entire speech. It is also reported elsewhere that Abu Bakr was the one who recited this speech in full out of his own memory. About Qus ibn Sa'idah, the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, "May Allah have mercy on Qus ibn Sa'idah. He will be resurrected as a separate nation in the hereafter."
Abdullah ibn Salam, the most learned rabbi among the Jews, came to see the Prophet when he arrived and asked him certain questions to ascertain his real prophethood. No sooner did he hear the Prophet's answers than he embraced Islam, but added that if his people knew of his Islamization, they would advance false arguments against him. The Prophet sent for some Jews and asked them about Abdullah ibn Salam. They testified to his scholarly aptitude and virtuous standing. Then it was revealed to them that he had embraced Islam, and on the spot they imparted categorically opposite testimonies and described him as the most evil of all evils. When the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 12 years old, he went with his uncle Abu Talib on a business journey to Syria. When they reached Basra, they met a monk called Bahira, who showed great kindness and entertained them lavishly. He had never been in the habit of receiving or entertaining them before. He readily enough recognized the Prophet and said while taking his hand, "This is the master of all humans. Allah will send him with a message which will be a mercy to all beings. Abu Talib asked, "How do you know that?" He replied, "When you appeared from the direction of Aqaba, all stones and trees prostrated themselves, which they never do except for a prophet. I can recognize him also by the seal of prophethood, which is below his shoulder, like an apple. We have got to learn this from our books." He also asked Abu Talib to send the boy back to Mecca and not take him to Syria for fear of the Jews. Abu Talib obeyed and sent him back to Mecca with some of his male servants.